into the home of a poor tenant farmer and his family, who lived in this area around 1750, not long after the crushing of Bonnie Prince Charlie's rebellion. But to understand the circumstances that led up to the development of this type of craft, we need to go further back in time, another 1500 years. When Vindolanda was still occupied by the Romans, a settlement had grown outside the walls of the fort. In many ways, the standard of civilian housing was better then. There was glass in the windows, and furniture and other possessions were often more sophisticated. But early in the 5th century AD, Roman government in Britain collapsed, and military support was withdrawn. With no money to pay soldiers, law and order broke down, and the trading economy of the region collapsed. Communities which had settled along the former northern frontier no longer had any reason to exist, and the people soon moved away. The Northumbrian uplands couldn't sustain more than a few farming families. Vindolanda soon fell into ruin. For a while, a handful of people continued to live on the site, scratching an increasingly uncertain living from the land. For many centuries after that, virtually the only human sounds to be heard would come from warring bands of raiders using the Staingate Road, or shepherds trying to round up their flocks. From around the 12th century onwards, this area was under the control of the Ridleys, the lords of Wilmotswick Castle. Their tenants lived a precarious life in small crofts, well out of sight of the dangerous Staingate Road, in the Tyne Valley hamlets of Thorngrafton, Millhouse, Towerhouse and Henshaw. Vindolanda and its surrounds reverted to a wooded wilderness, suitable only for summer grazing for sheep and the lords' hunting parties. Southwest Northumberland remained remote, desolate and poverty-stricken, all too often ravaged by passing armies of both English and Scots. But under later Tudor monarchs established better control over the frontier with Scotland, people began to expand out of the Tyne Valley into the once heavily populated uplands to the north. The turning point was the union of the crowns of England and Scotland in 1603. This effectively abolished the border and signalled the end of centuries of warfare. The map on the wall behind you shows the extent of local development. The lord of the manor would encourage crofting families to establish small holdings close to the Staingate Road. Four crofts were built above the Vindolanda ruins: Smith's Chesters, just northeast of the military bathhouse; Well Meadow Close, at the west end of the civilian settlement; Archie's Flat, over the remains of the cemeteries; and Bookie Burn, which was probably on the site of the parade ground. Nearby there was Cuddy Gate, Crow's Garth, High Fogrig, and the Fulling Mill at Scotshall. For the first time since the Roman occupation, people once more built homes and tilled the soil. To start with, families lived mainly in small dwellings made of turf and timber, often converted from the summer shelters used by shepherds. But over the next 100 years or so, housing standards were to improve. This little dwelling is based on the surviving remains of High Fogrig and Oates Close. It represents one of the better types of early 18th century crofts. The building materials would have been gathered from the plentiful supply of stones and roofing slates in the ruins of the nearby Vindolanda fort and settlement, and perhaps from Hadrian's Wall itself. That was probably the only advantage of living near the Roman remains, as the overgrown walls made it very difficult to clear the land, and much of the surrounding countryside was still heavily wooded and boggy. The room you stand in was used as a byre for the animals. The family lived in the other room, with loft space for children's beds and storage. The house is more primitive than the Roman civilian homes of centuries before. One of the few improvements is a chimney to remove most of the smoke from the fire. The family had a rather basic toilet, known in these parts as a netty. In spite of the ready-made sources of Roman quarried stone, the netty was constructed mainly from turf. For the people who lived in southwest Northumberland, 1750 was to be a decisive year. Work was about to start on the first new east-to-west road since Roman days. The B6318 military road would open up the area to trade, boost the agricultural economy, and encourage the exploitation of local minerals. The small crofts survived until the late 19th century. Then, most of them were swept away by landlords who wanted to create larger and more viable farm units. Even greater changes have taken place in the second half of the 20th century. From about 40 people in 1841, today, the resident population of the immediate Vindolanda area has fallen to only 4.